they've been present early here, how's that be, welcome home, buddy. If I'm gonna go through, the first thing that'll be on the agenda is the election of council offices. We know that there are two things that we look at. We look at the council offices, and then you also have Josephine provided the officers and committee assignments. Again, you write down what your preference of which committee you'd like to be on. Finance is always everyone, but the safety committee, streets and highways, public works, yada, yada. And then just turn that into whoever is elected, or give it to Josephine, she can get it to whoever's elected president of council, so those can be formulated. But tonight, we have president, vice president, parks and rec, and finance chair. I'll bring up two others. The JED board, Nick is already on it, but we have an opening due to the change of council members. And the cemetery board, it's a three-year term. We were not on last year, but we would be returning this year for 3 years. So it rotates around so that the communities all have someone on there. So Josephine, those last two, are they voted upon?
You can discuss it among yourself, except that the only thing I will say with regards to the JED, and cemetery, they do have a meeting on the 20th. So you might want to make a determination
tonight for the cemetery,
so that someone could be represented on.
And does the JED have a meeting set up yet?
To my knowledge.
I don't think so.
That's going to probably be a very hot committee this year with the Myers project and the discussions that they want to have potentially with us and the JED and all the rumors going around. So starting from the top, for council president.
I nominate Nick Molnar. Is that what we're supposed to do?
Well, we want to see who might be nominated. What happens when we go out on the floor, the mayor then calls. And if there's only going to be one, he'll call it a second time, would not expect a second one, and then can move right to the vote. Is there any other? Okay. Vice president?
I'll nominate Dave.
I'm not really interested.
You're not interested?
Oh, all right, I'll take it. Are you interested, Sylvia, or not?
Yeah, you want to be the ahead. Joe Biden of Macedonia?
You can nominate me.
All right, Sylvia wants to be nominated, too. That's fine, I'll take the nomination.
So we have Dave.
And Sylvia.
You're interested to be Joe Biden?
Yeah, I kind of
comes with a lot of power, you know. Okay. Parks and Rec, I would nominate Mr. Bilke. He has already been to a meeting and has already given feedback to that committee. I have no problem. Been on that committee since 1989 as a resident. So, unless someone else has a preference.
Sylvia, are you interested? I thought you said you might be.
Sure, I'd be interested.
All right, I'll nominate Sylvia.
Finance chair?
I'll nominate you, Jim.
Sylvia wants, I think, is interested. She did it last time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any others? And so before we forget, cemetery board, since we do have the meeting.
Seems to be your baby, huh? So you can have it.
I've been on the board. I know. There
you
is still a lot of work to do on that board.
You can have it.
I would have no problem being on that board.
It's a friendly group.
Yeah.
But it's a dead subject.
Is there anyone else that has an interest of working with? I see dead people. We actually have a lot of fun. I didn't know, but. Okay. Hearing no other discussion on that?
We're not going to decide on the JED?
We can. We can talk about the JED. Yeah.
I would be interested in the JED with Nick. I assume Nick wants to continue.
I, too, also am interested in that.
I'm interested in it also.
All right, then I'll withdraw my name from consideration of the JED.
So So who are we saying for the judge?
Kevin, Sylvia.
Anyone else?
You're not interested.
I'm already on, I think it's a two-year term.
You're already on the judge, you have no choice.
No, it's a permanent term, if you get appointed.
Right, I'll say no.
But I think the appointment's by the mayor, actually, isn't it?
Yes, I believe that it is by the mayor.
Traditionally, whoever's on the judge stays on the judge.
Right.
Until they win the lottery and leave council.
Well, it's important to have some continuity on the judge for certain.
I'd like to remain on there.
You've been on the judge?
Yes.
You were on the judge, I know I was on the judge.
All the previous appointments have been by ordinance.
Okay. Mr. Mayor, so you know.
We'll vote that one on the floor.
Cool. All right, moving right along. Resolution number 164, which was the independent audit of the city of Macedonia, that had its first reading. Sylvia, this one was yours.
Yep.
Do you have anything you wanna say?
When I spoke to the mayor, he said he was doing a preliminary review, and I think we can just hold it a second reading while he's doing that.
Is this on the check issues?
Yes.
Or it's on the credit card issues, I'm sorry.
Credit cards.
Sorry.
Well, it wouldn't just be the credit card.
Well, no, of course.
You should be doing the entire review.
But that was the original discussion.
Right. But
Yeah.
you take the whole audit, you don't just take one piece out of it, because it's a review of all our procedures.
Right, but the mayor said he was gonna take a particular look at that.
Second reading.
And I've been in that process, by the way.
Good, I appreciate that.
Okay, now I can put my stuff in order here. Next up, resolution number 3. This is for the law director, the assistant would be Tom Hanselak. The appointment for the law director would be Mark.
Mark, can you say your last name for us?
Gaddetti.
Gaddetti.
Thanks, Gaddetti.
I won't forget it ever.
Easiest way to remember.
Perfect.
Mark G. Dave, would you take that one?
I prefer not.
Thanks. Discussion?
Did you hear what I said?
Pardon me?
You said thanks, I said no.
Oh, why not?
Cause I said I would prefer not.
Okay, I'll take it, no problem. Any discussion on this? This basically provides continuity in my mind of a law firm that has truly assisted in the city since I've been here. Brought us money, won us cases, found us money when we weren't even sure.
I'll have some questions for Mark on the floor, if that's okay.
Sure.
I would prefer that we hold this at first reading. And I will have some comments on the floor.
If we hold it at first reading, we don't have, who do we have as the law director?
Well, the law director remains in place until we replace him.
Mr. Deemer and Mr. Hanselak.
Okay, so the firm still stays as is.
Sure.
Okay, Kevin, what is your comments?
Well,
this is the time usually to bring them out.
Well, I just wanted him to introduce himself. I wanted to know from Mark, other than Macedonia, where are you other acting legal counsel for?
Thank you, sir.
We've been legal counsel for a variety of political subdivisions in Northeast Ohio. Right now, I'm assistant law director for Mayfield Village, just my primary other municipality.
So you're the named assistant law director there?
Right. Well, there's an ordinance that's pending. It's gonna be next week.
Okay.
But I've been acting as assistant law director here the past 9 months there.
Okay.
And then we specifically prosecuted for Zoldy Redmond and assistant Shred Ball.
Okay. And named assistant, so you'll be okay. And what was your role here in Macedonia? Always, you know, being obviously my first meeting, I've met you before, but I never knew exactly how you came into play here in Macedonia.
Right, so I came on board Mr. Deemer's firm in 2007 as a clerk. I was hired on the end of 2008, and I've been working on City of Macedonia issues the entire time.
Okay.
As you, I think, you know, I grew up here.
Right.
And, you know, so, you know, the city of Macedonia is near and dear to my heart. But I've been involved in pretty much, I'd say, 89% of the issues that have occurred throughout the last three-quarter decade.
Okay.
In the city.
So this would be your first law director appointment?
Correct.
Now, I guess in your role, Are you planning to have anyone other than yourself, Mr. Hanselak, attending the meetings like such as I saw you over the last couple of years?
I don't foresee the need for anybody else now. If both of us had a conflict and couldn't make it, somebody else from the firm I would likely select from.
Okay, do you have a person in mind?
Dan or Joe.
Okay.
If I had her available.
Okay.
But like I said, I anticipate I'm gonna be covering the vast majority of the meetings.
Okay, thank you. That's kind of, where is that? I guess in my life, if it means, we're naming you as the law director and not the firm that you are looking for.
Correct.
Okay.
Any other questions? Okay, hearing none, we'll move on to ordinance number four, which is the appointment of the Chagrin Valley Engineering of Donald Sheehy. Mayor, did you want to say anything?
Just that Chagrin Valley is located in Oakwood Village, right around the corner from us. So they've been in business probably 15-plus years. The firm holds probably 15 or 16 municipalities, cities and villages in Cuyahoga County. They are well-versed in all the issue two and all the other type of grant funds, ODOT, what have you. They're certainly going to be a lot cheaper for the city. Their rates are much less than what we were being charged through GPD. And so we're going to see a large savings in that area.
Do I have a question? Would you mind?
Sure.
You know, obviously, we have a large group of the city that's concerned about stormwater, particularly those people on ledge by 71 or 271.
Mm-hmm. Right.
We did a study, which it's never been reported to council. So I guess my only concern is,
where's that at?
Well, where's that at? How's that going to go over to Chagrin Valley, or do we need to keep GPD in the loop at least till that is finished? Because I don't want to let this just sit, and I know that the people down there are very concerned.
Nor do I. The study's completed.
Okay.
It's being delivered to us. There's going to be a meeting between GPD and Chagrin Valley next week, and they will exchange all information as it relates to anything ongoing. We provide them with the PDF and other documents that are necessary for Chagrin Valley to hit the ground running on the various open-ended items.
So we own the study.
We own the study because we'd already paid for it. And and I wish we probably would have held back on that study, by the way, because I probably could have got any ORSD to pay for it. And we wouldn't have had to go out and spend any money. It would have come through the new program that we're going to have with them. So nevertheless, we're at where we're at, and we'll get the study, and we're going to try to work with NEORSD to try to get some of those problems taken care of over there. That's one of the areas that we've identified.
When do you anticipate us having the ability to disseminate that information to the public?
I'm going to guess after next Wednesday's meeting. We'll have the document in hand, and we'll know what the study showed, and then we'll probably then let Chagrin Valley make their recommendations as to how we should tackle it and where we should go with it. And we'll also then meet with NEORSD to see what they're willing to do for us in remedying that problem. I mean, one property owner over there is willing to give us up some land in his backyard so that we can put a retention back there, which I think is what really needs to happen back there. And NEORSD, I think, is willing to give us some funding to do it.
But when we talked about this last summer, there seemed to be a great urgency at the time, and I think we all were concerned a little bit about exactly what this study was going to produce. Now, the study has been completed, and they should have had opportunity to look at everything there. Are there recommendations in the study? Have you seen it?
I haven't seen it. No.
Okay.
It was too big of a document to send it by way of PDF. So therefore, they said that they would deliver it. So I'm
They're gonna deliver multiple copies then?
I'm assuming, yes, so that they'll deliver it.
So after the meeting next Wednesday, it should be available.
Yeah.
Okay, about the ordinance itself, are there any other questions?
What do we anticipate saving?
It's.
You said that we're gonna save money, do you have an
Do I have an idea? Well, I'll give you an idea. For example, I kinda did a little bit of an analysis on just one item, if you will, and that was like the sewer culvert. I think we paid about $43,000 in engineering there for that culvert. And under Chagrin Valley would have been about 25.
Well, that's one of the things it's basically a contract here with Chagrin Valley, and I think we need to look at some of the detail here and how this is going to work. And I think you know that I suggested that we talk to several firms and get bids on this kind of arrangement, because I think that's the guarantee we will save money. And we have expended a lot of money in the past in some ways that I don't think were very productive. And so I think from this particular area here, it says you want to hire him as of February 5th. Again, I think we ought to, this is a complex contractual arrangement here at this point. And I think we need to hold it at first reading and give some opportunity to look at this and give us some detail on what we really think we're going to be paying for the coming projects.
I disagree, and I think that I am pretty good at identifying who's good out there and who's not. And if we don't pass it tonight, I'm going to ask that we call 3 immediate special meetings or 2 more following this.
I'm asking the question, if we do not pass this tonight, does the meeting next week occur?
No, I can't put them on, and I'm in between giving them notice already that we're terminating GPD, and so they're going to come to an end. And
so
I need to be able to function in the city. I can't continue to wait for things.
The effective date says February 5th, but the meeting would be the 20th of January. He's willing to come in before his effective date.
Correct.
Well, then if he's willing to do that, I think that we should just allow him to do that. And I'm not saying anything other than we need to, this is a complex contract, we need to look at this in detail, and it's our responsibility as council to do that. So I don't see any emergency here. If you want to call these meetings, that's another thing, but I think we should just productively look at it, let them have a meeting next week if they want to.
Anyone else have some comments or questions? Nick, can you take this one?
Yeah, I think it'd be my opinion that, you know, I trust in your ability to choose a company that you feel will be best for us, and I think your intent with going with this company is that we would in fact save money with them. And I know
Absolutely.
That you even put a press release out there that you have dealt with them in the past, and you even went as far as to say, is that a conflict? And I respect the fact that you did that because you avoided, you know, future issues going down the road. So for me, I don't see the reasoning to hold this up. I think your intent is the right one to save the city some money, so I'd like to move forward with it.
Anything else? Okay. Number 5 is...
So, a ton of, are we only going one on that then? Or is it, are we... What's
personally, I'm not seeing why we're going to do one. I've already read the contract. It was attached. It was presented to us in advance. Any questions we could have had, we could have presented to the PIC mayor in the past 2 days. I trust his judgment. And I also know it's going to save us some money. We had discussions before this legislation about keeping GPD and making changes. And so, I support it. Mm-hmm. I would go 1, 2, 3, personally. I want the savings, and I want someone here. We have stormwater. And we have roads. We got 2 hot issues that
if the issue is that you want to take it out to bid, then I don't agree with that. You don't hire companies based on what gives you the best price. You hire what's best for your city.
Bid does not mean best price, but it's
well,
best
why
value.
Why would you bid it out?
Because
then?
You want to see, obviously you want the best combination of services and price.
And you don't think this company can supply that to the city?
I'm saying that you can't really tell that. Like when last year when we had our desire to have, go to that trash company without any bidding, which you may not have been here when that happened.
I was not. Tonight's my first meeting.
And we did in fact insist upon going out for bid, and we got a much better price out of them. So that's all I'm saying.
I mean, that's rubbish.
Well, but that's still.
This is the city's.
No, it wasn't rubbish.
It wasn't rubbish, but nonetheless.
This is the city's engineering department.
Well, it's true, and we have GPD right now.
I mean, do we have projects right now that are gonna be put on hold?
I'm telling you my opinion, and I have seen.
You're entitled to it, you're right.
Right.
All I can say is if you take the contract that GPD had with the city, and you compare the one from Chagrin Valley, you're gonna certainly see the hourly is much less for the principals that will be working here, and all the way down the list, as well as any project that they may encounter for, such as like the Soup Bridge, and the cost of difference would have been, like I said, $25,000 versus $43,000 in engineering fees. So I think if you base it on those numbers, I think that that's the reality, and that's what you're gonna find. And, you know, it's, Don Sheehy, by the way, is one of probably only a few that it possesses a PEPS similar to Joe Schiavone that we put on our planning commission, but very experienced, understands all of the disciplines of engineering, and comes highly recommended, not only from the fact that I had used him in the past, but the fact that many municipalities throughout Northeast Ohio use their firm.
Yes, I know. I'm not saying anything critical about Chagrin Valley Engineering. I did not see, and I did compare to the, it's a little difficult to tell because you can't tell which particular people used on which projects. So it's always difficult to tell exactly what the differences would be. But let me just make this comment that the price of this really comes down to whether or not how many hours are expended primarily. And that's something that we need to be looking at in terms of how we contract and the actual ordinance. So I really don't see that there's, you know, this is, we have another meeting in January. I'll have more time and I can even give you feedback on some of the concerns that I have. But I personally don't think there's an emergency here yet. And they, if they're willing to go to a meeting before February 6th, then I'd allow them to go to a meeting.
Any other thoughts?
I don't have a problem.
I just think we've terminated our relationship, and anytime you make this kind of change, it probably makes sense just to move forward. I think it's time. We have a lot of projects coming up, and I don't really want to shuffle our feet on this one. I trust in the administration making the right decision, because obviously his intent is to save us money, and he'll be watching over that.
The other thing that you should be aware of is, since we don't have a permanent budget, we won't be doing major plans until we can get that in place.
We do have enough to get us through the first quarter.
We do, but it's a temporary
budget. And then we'll then be putting together before the end of the first quarter by law. We must have a permanent budget, so that's not an issue. Okay, Nick, why don't you just offer 1, 2, 3, and we'll see what happens. Number 5 is the appointment of Mr. Nadovich as public service for the city of Macedonia. Nick, do you want to take that one too? I don't know if he's here.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Nadovich.
That is number 5?
Yes.
Well, we started with.
Yeah, no, I
didn't
that.
Page properly.
Right.
That's all.
Okay.
I think I got this one.
So you're a glutton for pain?
Absolutely.
Molnar's taking that.
Are you comfortable with everything? I mean, this is what you want, obviously. And you ready to move forward?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Any questions?
I think we should do third reading.
Yeah.
1, 2, 3.
Yep. Yeah.
You got it.
Who's doing it?
Thank you, John. John, I've got to say, on behalf of those residents that we've worked with as your interim, thank you. There's been a lot of issues that we know we've talked about, from poles to streets to potholes to water main. You've bathed by fire, buddy, and you've really pulled through. Thank you. Okay, number 6 is the Sylvia As the current finance chair, we can take that one. This is to transfer funds to take care of our bills for the legal arrears. Mayor, these are past due.
Yes. I have some questions. What are the unpaid obligations? Because that's what it says, the unpaid obligations from 2015.
Well, I believe that these are bills that, as I understand them, they've been sitting, waiting to be paid because they had not been appropriated.
I guess I understand the definition of what unpaid means, but what specifically are there? And I have not got the list to look at it.
I think they're for maintenance.
Okay, so it's just to one place?
No, I think it's for four or five separate unpaid obligation plans.
No, I guess my question is just to the law department.
Sorry, I didn't mean to try.
So no one else, so, okay.
I can give you insight.
This is the $33,000?
Correct.
Okay.
I can give you insight as to what this is about, if you wish to know that, because I have a spreadsheet, and I can send you a copy, Kevin, if you'd like to have it.
Could you copy all of this?
This gets us to hold for the first of, this will get us to hold for the first of the year.
If you don't catch us up.
And it will close out 2015.
We took out the $40,000, we took out the money the last December meeting, and you remember that. It's partial, it's.
We made a partial payment.
I know there was.
So, but are you saying it's for all of last year, or there's gonna be still more owed out from last year?
I believe that 33 will bring us up to date.
I don't think that there's anything outstanding above this $33,000.
That was my question. I kinda knew what the 33 was for, but it didn't specifically.
Other than current expenses.
Okay.
Let me tell you exactly where this, because I have, as I say, keeping a spreadsheet on the legal costs. And on the Plough Farnhurst matter, and the billing from November, December escalated to, from approximately $1,000 a month to, between those 2 months, $15,000 some dollars. And I do have some concerns about that because of the disqualification of the Deemer firm and the Plough Farnhurst matter. The other two areas where we have had.
What does the disqualification have to do with it?
Because they're charging for something of which they're disqualified to represent the city. They can represent themselves.
Are the bills for after the disqualification?
Yes, certainly the December bill is. I can't tell on the November bill exactly.
So I guess I read somewhere where the law department is, I believe it's supposed to represent the city in all legal matters?
Well, that's what Mr. Deemer said, but in reality, the judge said something else. And I do have the documents here from the federal court website that shows exactly the sequence, which says, and the judge says very clearly, they can represent themselves, but not any of the city.
Maybe Mark can answer these questions. We talked a little bit about it. Let me refer to my notes. So the way that the suit was filed, you said it was filed in five different, some, you know, in three different ways. Are any of the people named? Because isn't, I think Mike Ladd, Don Kupta, and Nick Vigneault named as defendants?
Right.
So would they be responsible for any punitive damage out of pocket if it did more against this?
The way the complaint's drafted, it's kind of an allegation against all defendants that are named in the complaint.
Okay.
So, and that's, there's various aspects. I'm not gonna talk too much about it, obviously, because it's a pending matter, but there are certain causes of actions for which the city is not covered by insurance counsel, which was one of the reasons we have a lot of department.
That was my next question. So are they supposed to?
Damages, estoppel, deck action.
So when Deemer and Havlicek were disqualified, were they supposed to seek independent counsel? Or were the law department still represent them?
That's what Councilwoman Hannigan's referring to. If you read the judge's opinion.
I have it with me, and I'm gonna enter it in the record.
So do you think that they should get independent counsel?
Yes, they should have gotten it, in my opinion, as soon as they were added as defendants in March by the judge, in March of 2014. They did not do so. So ever since that point.
You think the city should reimburse them for it?
No, I think that they should reimburse the city. We were paying them
No, I'm talking that if Mike Lett had to go out and get his own lawyer to defend himself.
Well, no, the insurance company attorney, the insurance company attorney is representing all of them, including Mr. Hanselick.
But he just said not in the punitive damages.
Just to be clear, I think.
Yeah, he's.
We don't, we have no.
How about we do this, guys? We only have, you know, I'm not gonna, I want the lawyers at the table, not the, I think.
Okay, that's fine with me. I just have some questions about it.
No, I'm not talking about, I think, I've got the documents.
Why don't we do, Sylvia, do first reading on it?
Yes.
There was a lot of documentation presented by the law department that talked about this.
Okay.
It was in the email dated January 10th, if you've read it. I mean, it did talk about it.
I did.
Instead of saying, I read this on a federal website, that's open then for interpretation, and unless you're a lawyer, you gotta be careful, because your interpretation could be skewed the wrong way. So, Mr. G, we need to, is there just a way to take that 33-129 and say, or mayor, so much of it is this, so much of it is that? Or if it was part of a retainer that wasn't paid, because we already were, you know, we got rid of the retainer, which then cost us more money, because we went to billable hours.
Yeah, we can, I think we can line item the amounts of that.
Mr. Gaddetti, can you
provide us something in that fashion then?
Sure.
Okay.
Can you send us all a copy of the order disqualifying the firm, so that we know exactly the date it took place, and we know what the language is? I think that might help us too.
Okay, so we'll do first reading.
Dave, I do have a copy of the order, and I will enter it in the record tonight, and I'll send you.
Can we?
But he should send it to everybody.
Yes.
We do the first reading under agreement that the law department will not consider us in arrears and begin charging us interest, which they have by law the right to do. Mark, did you hear that?
I did.
Okay.
He slyly ignored you.
I know, but by law, you have the right to do that.
We're not gonna do it.
Okay.
Thank you, Mark.
Moving on to number 8 and 9, those are mine.
Seven.
Did I skip one?
You did, seven.
Oh, you know why? Because I didn't print that one. Number 7, the establishing the compensation schedule. Sylvia, if you'll introduce that as the finance chair. Mayor, if you would like to speak to that, or?
This is a compensation that is, coincides with the increases that were given to the unions. And Claudia's here, so I always bow to our HR director, who does a very good job. She can probably fill you in as well as I can.
Yes, a lot of it is just kind of cleanup language. We've had some title changes throughout the year that we've adjusted on the compensation schedule. As you'll see, you know, we updated the members of council. Everyone's at the same salary now. It's one example. We've added a few positions, as the mayor is like to head in a different direction in some ways. We've updated the compensation range, so the pay grades, so as the employees receive the 2.75 increase, that will increase with them. I added a few more notes clarifying what exempt versus non-exempt positions are within the city, which, as you might know, has to do with the Fair Labor Standards Act. Those are really the big changes here, and I don't really think of them as changes, just more clerical updates and administrative type things. So.
The pay ranges, have they been increased, or are they still the same?
No, they did increase 2.75%, as we are giving a 2.75% increase to all the non-union employees.
So sometimes we have done that, sometimes we have adjusted, sometimes we've left the pay ranges the same.
Yeah.
And allowed people to move up inside the pay ranges. So we did increase the pay ranges last year, so.
If we increase the pay ranges every time we give annual raise, why do we?
Then we were in trouble.
Why do we have pay ranges? That's my whole point. I thought pay ranges were based upon a determination of the value of the service rendered for those positions. So.
Well, your point is well taken. The reason it was done last year was that we hadn't done it for a few years.
Right.
Okay, so it's not necessarily done every year. And I think we should keep this at first reading. There's some additional detail in there concerning the law department, which maps up to the other ordinance that we're just discussing concerning the water permit. So.
Does this do any impact on current pay?
It will just, obviously, since this is dated back to January 1, it's going to create a little more work on our payroll administrator in doing the retro pay for the employees.
We've done it.
But outside of that, it's not too intrusive, no.
So it is, if, once we pass it, it is retroactive?
Right, it says it.
Okay, but it will, so we don't want to belabor this into March, guys, because it becomes more of a detriment in over, someone having to work a lot additional hours. Plus, if the only concern is the law department, I'm not sure what else would be a concern, but make sure you put together your questions and get them to the mayor for Claudia so we can get them answered at our next meeting.
Well, I guess one question that Dave has just raised is, should we have a basically expanded the pay range again, or should we try to maintain them within a certain range? And then as people do get raises over time, then there may be a need to adjust it, but we don't necessarily have to do it every year. And that would
in the
one
traditional
thing.
Business world, you have a scale, minimum met and maximum. And you may never hit maximum, but is there as an incentive for an employee? So to say I will only raise the maximum when I think it's due, that's not how general business works. And I know that because I had my appraisal this morning. So we're talking maximum minimums and the midpoint. In a lot of cases, if you show a midpoint at X and a maximum never grows, it's a reverse incentive. So, you know, this is something that is traditionally used. So we'll do first reading and then get your questions together. Moving on to 8 and 9, and I take them together because there are two things I will offer them. There are two things that I talked about last year. I'm going to offer them both up for first reading. One is to repeal the council members' health care plan. The other is to repeal the recreation fee discount. The reason I'm offering them for first reading is to be able to have the residents have some dialogue, what their thoughts are on it. Healthcare, I've heard from, you know, we'll get more people to run for office. I haven't met somebody yet who ran because of the healthcare. The discounts on the recreation center, I'm not even sure anyone was ever taking it. There's only one other person I usually see up there, which is you, so. So I'm going to offer those for first reading. Number 10, am I right?
I believe so.
Okay. Yes.
Sylvia, this is your checkbook.com.
Yes. Right. And I did have an opportunity to speak to a couple of people who are coordinating with the Summit County area and this Northeast Ohio. And I did, in fact, confirm that there are several cities, including Streetsboro, who are on OhioCheckbook.com now, with the fact that our particular accounting system already has a template, which is the same template that they use in Streetsboro and a number of other places in this area. I have to say, I did go out and look at OhioCheckbook.com. You can go out there and look, and it's very informative. What it shows you about monthly expenditures and the general trends of expenditures. They have good, very good charts with it. So the whole point of this is to increase the transparency and visibility of our expenditures so the residents have a convenient place to look and see all that information. And
do the residents right now have a place to get all the information?
No, not really.
They wouldn't be able to get
all
the information.
Well, public records, of course, but the point is that this is this doesn't require.
How much more work would this do to someone who had to enter this into the computer?
Not very much, actually. I looked at the template and I talked to them, and basically they take the output from the accounting system and dump it into the the spreadsheets that's used by the.
That's not the only problems I have, but that was just two off the top of my head.
Right, right. Well, I'm telling you, that's, they've already worked it through for our particular accounting system, and there, the, a template is available, so really, it's not really that much work at all. So, and they don't charge you for it either.
I've talked to a number of fellow mayors, and none of communities surrounding us, and many in Cuyahoga County don't use it, so I.
I understood Akron was going to bring it up shortly, too.
What were the reasons why they said they didn't want to use it?
Well, it, first of all, causes them to have to put more time into the finance department and have them putting this stuff up. It's busy enough in our finance department, let alone having to create more detail for some other document that you gotta continue to watch. And if somebody wants a record of our city, they certainly can ask for a public records request, and we give it to them.
I think that.
I mean, we only had 50, or how many last year, public records requests, so if somebody wants it, they can call in and ask for it.
That's true, I think the.
The mayor complained all last year and the year before about public records.
I said, well, that's what I'm saying, though, I.
He complained about them, this would.
If residents want it, let them call up and make a request.
Well, then they can go on to, and the amount of work here is very small, we can, you're talking.
Are there any other questions?
If there's, I guess for me, I'm thinking about our situation currently with a new fire instructor coming into play, and not only that, I wanna see how this thing plays out. I'm curious to see, I smell political fishiness in this. And I've heard some things about why this is coming out now, and it's helping a campaign, but that's irrelevant. What I'm really after is, we've got a new fire instructor coming in right now, and I think we need to give that person some time to get settled before we throw more things onto her back. I'm not opposed to this, but I wanna see it play out a little bit and give this lady some time to dip her feet in the water and get comfortable before we add things to her plate.
Well, we could do first reading. I have some concerns because it crashed. It's not proven yet. It's a system that has had some issues with it. Mr. Mandel has admitted it had issues to it. I think it needs to be proven before we put our information out there. And the communities that are out there, I'm not seeing large communities. Do first reading, do a little more homework on it. I can't see the benefit right now.
Well, I think the residents can see what we're spending money on and who we're spending money with.
This would be a public.
This is a, just on a website, yes, it's a.
Right.
It's a website that is paid for by the state. They do, they provide the template for you to be able to take the output from your accounting system, which shows all your payments.
Created by the state treasurer, who could change at the end of an election.
Well,
and be gone, or be altered again.
I wouldn't mind holding it on first reading, I wanna do some more research into it.
Can I ask Sylvie to finish?
I thought she was done.
Well.
It's free, it's got a template, and she sent us.
Yes, I did.
She sent us one paper on it.
I did, and I also have a list of the communities that have our particular accounting system that have already put this thing into place. So I will forward that to everyone so that they can go out and look at it.
Great.
And I'm happy to go first reading. And I just think that there's nothing to be concerned about. It's purely, it's a digital access by the residents to what we're spending money on. That's all it's doing.
I just have a concern that it's crashed. Has been proven.
Well, every new
as
system
someone who works
crashed.
In IT and has worked in IT, numbers can, if it's not accurate, life can be very ugly. Number 11 and 12 are our parks. We have one opening that we're filling, and we have one reappointment. I was going to call it renewal, but it's not really a renewal. It's a reappointment. Mr. Greer is the reappointment. Mr. Greer has been very active, positive, great thoughts as a member of the Parks and Rec Commission. I would ask we do 1, 2, 3. Kevin, would you like to do your first one?
No, I don't know about it. Yeah, sure, I'll try it. I'm reading over my crib notes right now.
Could I ask just a question here? How are we going about selecting these folks, the reappointments? Obviously, somebody has been on the commission before.
Kenneth's been on the commission. We traditionally reappoint the same as we did on other commissions. And Karen has actually, in fact, if you'd like to know anything about Karen, she's sitting here. Karen actually has been in attendance at our meetings, has been already vocal, has already given us some great ideas, and actually pursued the fact that she would like to become a member when appropriate. Now, ancient history, how did I become a member of the Parks and Rec Board? The exact same way. I became very active in the parks and that was happening, founded the soccer thing and said, okay, let's take this forward, and was then part of the committee that founded the actual rec center. I feel very confident, Karen. Do you want to say something for the, I mean, we have?
No, I just want to serve.
Is Kevin doing that one too?
Yep, we're gonna make Kevin do both.
Oh, jeez.
Third reading for both of them.
I got a second shot at it, huh?
Just remember, you don't have to read it, so saying Karen's last name.
That's true, that's true.
Whatever.
Anything else?
Yeah, I have a question on the resolution number three. I think you mentioned that we're gonna try to do three readings. How is that gonna work?
You offer it, and we take a vote.
Say what?
I mean, that's.
Oh, I thought that was on four.
I also.
That was on four.
I have the Ohio.
I thought it was on three.
It was on four.
On four.
Okay.
Yeah. I have the Ohio checkbook up online if anybody wants to take a look at it. I've looked at it before.
So, are we gonna vote to three readings and then we're gonna vote on the measure?
Yes, that's how it works.
Okay.
So the first thing out is the officers, the mayor will ask if there's any nominations, if there's a second, then oppose it, then we vote on each position, then we go into legislative.
No, I understand that process, but I thought Sylvia wanted to hold it to first reading.
Which one?
Three is gonna be first reading.
You're good with four, but we're on the third reading.
I said that I preferred it to stay at the first reading. Other people that said they didn't, so we will see.
But you're a council of five.
Okay.
So. Thank you for indulging.
Thank you for the meeting.
Next time. Joe Biden.
Joe, I see that you moved your seat up at the dais. Or is it the gavel just?
Yeah, this is a, I don't even know.
Oh.
Here's the.
Okay, I thought that someone moved the gavel.
It was operated.